You approach the lip of the half pipe. Elbow pads, check. Knee pads, check, check. Helmet? Helmet? Check. Your friends are all watching in anticipation. The peer pressure cooker is turned up to a gajillion. Under your breath, you whisper the words, "I can do this." You peek out from under your helmet to make sure your friends can't tell that on the inside, you're freaking out right now. Holding your breath, you drop in. Down the half pipe you go, and up the other side, you reach the lip and float off, suspended in midair.
What?
You may have just reached skate nirvana, or maybe it's a really awesome dream. You know it's not reality. Why? What goes up must come down. Humans have long realized this without understanding why it was the case. But one day, a young Cambridge University student was sitting under a tree when he felt a hollow thwack on his head.
Oh!
An apple. Now, this last part may be stretching the truth. There is no evidence to say that there was any apple-to-head contact, but it makes for a good story, right? We do know that this student witnessed a falling apple, which caused him to ask, why do things fall to the ground? Why aren't they suspended in midair? Why don't they travel in a different direction? Good questions, right? Speaking of questions, let's get into ours for today. While you watch, consider the following. What role did Isaac Newton play in the scientific revolution? How did the scientific revolution contribute to advancements in medical practice, vaccinations, and scientific instruments? And what were the broader effects of the scientific revolution? After the video, think about the big picture question that we considered in our last lesson. You'll have even more context after this video to answer how did innovations in science impact the way people thought about themselves and the institutions around them. All right, historians, let's drop in. Perhaps there was no greater titan of math and science than Sir Isaac Newton, the star of our introductory scene. Before graduating from Cambridge University in England, he had not only begun his study of gravity, but also came up with the idea of calculus, a mathematical study of the rate of change. The defining work of the scientific revolution was Newton's Mathematical Principles of Natural Philosophy, published in 1687 and one of the most influential books in history. Timelines of the scientific revolution often end around 1687, as Newton's writings are thought to cap off the revolutionary process and usher in a world in which science was, well, a part of daily life. In his book, Newton built on the work of Galileo in his study of motion, but took it a step further by proving Galileo's theories mathematically. Kepler had theorized that planets moved in an elliptical orbit around the sun. But how did the sun control planetary motion? Newton answered this with his greatest contribution to modern science, the law of gravity. He explained that gravity governed all matter on Earth and in space, including planetary motion. All of this was supported using calculus, providing mathematical proof for the motion of objects. He described the workings of the universe as a giant clock, set in motion by God, synchronized perfectly. Newton synthesized the work of prior scientists and explained all of it mathematically. Here's how the world works, and here's how I can prove it's true. So let's review. What role did Isaac Newton play in the scientific revolution? Advancements were made in a number of fields. Much of what medieval Europeans understood about anatomy and medicine was based on the work of Galen, an ancient Greek physician who had never actually dissected a human corpse.
Ew!
Galen, for instance, said that men had more teeth than women. Not true. Apparently, Galen didn't decide to ask two people, can you open up and show me your chompers? And he thought that a human body internally was identical to a pig's body. Andreas Vesalius was a Flemish physician who dissected and studied human bodies and showed that Galen's assumptions were wrong. He published On the Structure of the Human Body in 1543, a book filled with detailed drawings of human organs, bones, and muscle, which would revolutionize the practice of surgery. The incredibly deadly smallpox virus ravaged the world for 3,000 years. You're safe thanks to English surgeon Edward Jenner, who in the late 18th century successfully pioneered the vaccination process, thus paving the way for widespread protection from a host of diseases that would otherwise cause lasting damage to, or even kill, well, a lot of us. The first microscope was created in 1590 by Dutch eyeglass maker Zacharias Janssen. By the 1670s, Dutch scientist Anton van Leeuwenhoek was using microscopes to observe bacteria and red blood cells. The first mercury barometer was developed in 1643 by Galileo's student Evangelista Torricelli, and by the early 18th century, mercury was being used in thermometers to measure temperature, pioneered by Gabriel Fahrenheit and Anders Celsius. The first modern chemist was Irishman Robert Boyle. He pioneered the use of the scientific method in chemistry. His 1661 book, The Skeptical Chemist, proposed that matter was made up of smaller primary particles that were joined together, elements. And Boyle's Law, a mainstay of high school chemistry classes worldwide, explains how volume and pressure of gas affect each other. Let's review with two questions. Our first one is, how did the scientific revolution contribute to advancements in medical practice, vaccinations, and scientific instruments? Name an example of each. Our second question is, do any of these scientific advancements play a role in your life? Explain. So what did we learn from these intrepid explorers of the scientific world? Well, we gained a new, dare I say, revolutionary understanding of astronomy, physics, chemistry, and medicine. The scientific revolution transformed the notion of science from a collection of unsupported, random observations about the world to a recognized and respected discipline based on methodology and constructive experimentation. It also sparked a shift in European focus from religion to science. The teachings of the church about the natural world were no longer simply accepted as fact, but were cross-checked using the scientific process. Science became part of our understanding of everyday life. The scientific method revolutionized the way that people gained understanding about the world. It created the framework for an agreed-upon step-by-step process for reaching a conclusion. As a result, scientists were able to trust their research and thereby make further conclusions. The Baconian goal of using science to harness the natural world for human use came to fruition, at least to some extent. In the 18th century, the Industrial Revolution would begin in Great Britain, using technology built on the application of science. Nations that rapidly embraced science and resulting technology began to emerge as world leaders in the 19th century. Science has been used both to nourish by means of advancements in medicine and food production, and to destroy by means of the technology of warfare. Now let's review. What were the broader effects of the scientific revolution? You've noticed that we've spent the last three lessons talking as much about science as about history. But do you remember our course tagline, "History is everywhere"? That's because it is everywhere. History and science are indelibly linked. Historical events cause people to think more about science, and science creates and changes history. We can't truly understand the era between 1750 and 1950 without understanding the changes that occurred at the beginning of this era. These scientific breakthroughs were rooted in the concepts of reason and order, which caused philosophers and scholars to rethink long-standing beliefs about humanity, particularly personal rights and liberties. This began a movement known as the Enlightenment, and it's where we're off to next. Until next time, don't forget that science and history are everywhere.